Welcome to the Information Security Forum podcast. I'm your host, Tavia Gilbert, and we are in the studio today with ISF Managing Director Steve Durbin. Today's conversation is the second of a four-part series exploring the most significant areas of threat. If you missed our last discussion about the increased sophistication of cybercrime, including ransomware, be sure to go back to the securityforum.org media page and get caught up. Today, we promised a discussion about the impact of legislation, so let's dive right in. National and regional legislators and regulators are trying to keep pace with existing developments, but because of the speed at which everything is changing, they're destined to fail in their ability to address the needs of a world eagerly grasping revolutionary technologies. At present, most organizations have insufficient knowledge and resources to keep abreast of current and pending legislation. Steve, talk to us about the impact of legislation. Give us an overview.
I think there's a number of elements to legislation, Tavia, that we need to look at from a whole threat standpoint. And some people may be listening to this and thinking, well, why is legislation a threat? Well, it's a threat for a couple of reasons. The first is that there is an inherent implication, I think, in legislation, for me anyway, that compliance with legislation will somehow ensure security. And the two are very separate things. Mm. So you can be compliant, but not necessarily secure. So I think that we need to be very careful about exactly what legislation is there to do. So that's the first point. I think the second thing that we have to understand is that with an increase in legislation also comes an increased burden in terms of resource to actually deal with that legislation. I'm thinking particularly here of organizations that are operating across multiple jurisdictions, really trying to keep abreast with that. And if you add into it the need for compliance as well, at a time when we see organizations coming under fairly acute skill shortages and resource shortages, some would say that that's not particularly helpful. So the threat inherent in that is it distracts you from some of the other things that you might be doing. Resources are taken away from some of the other programs that you might be running in pursuit of falling in line with some form of legislation. Now, that isn't to say that legislation is a bad thing. And so I'm very, I suppose, particular about this threat. And it is about the impact of legislation. It's about the impact on an organization. So in that, what we really need to understand is there isn't a way in which we're going to prevent legislation coming about. We can lobby. There has been certain pieces of legislation that have really required quite a broad amount of input. I'm thinking of things like the General Data Protection Regulation in the EU. I'm thinking about some of the standards in the United States. So the NIST framework, for instance, although not legislation, it is a framework. Mm-hmm. And so I'd include it in that. So those for me are good examples where we've had fairly solid input into what makes sense. And as a result, I think we've got some legislation or some standards coming out that people can adopt and certainly are adopting. But the real challenge within all of this is, as I say, how do you keep abreast of some of the implications? And let's drill into that in a little bit more detail. Mm-hmm. So on the one hand, we can say if I'm a multinational organization and I operate across a number of different jurisdictions, there's clearly a requirement for me to understand what I need to do in each of those. And it doesn't have to be outside of the country. If you look at the United States, for instance, you have different state laws. So if you're in California, there is a certain set of legislation there that may not apply if you happen to be in Missouri or Kentucky, for instance. Mm-hmm. And yet, if you're providing service across all of those states, you'd need to be cognizant, certainly, of that. That's relatively simple for organizations to get their heads around. Mm-hmm. What we're starting to see, though, is some new forms of legislation that are beginning to be a little bit more prescriptive about, for instance, where you store data. I'm thinking of certainly the first one that came out was in Russia, the requirement to store personal data that refers to Russian citizens within Russian borders. We've seen Vietnam come out with that fairly recently as well. We've started to see other countries also introduce different levels of legislation or regulation that impact data. And that's where it starts to get complicated, mm-hmm. particularly if you're an organization that has adopted, say, cloud technology. If you've gone down that road, one of the attractions of cloud was you could put your information into the cloud mm-hmm. and didn't really need to understand where it was. Yes, okay, you probably needed to know if you were in the European Union, whether or not it was being held within the EU borders, and there was certainly some requirement for that. But again, that was relatively simple. What we're starting to see, though, is very much more of a requirement for you to understand as a user now where your data is. Mm-hmm. You know, which servers does it sit on? And so you have to ask that question of your cloud provider. And I think that, again, for some very large organizations, that's fine. They understand that. They have teams that are able to do that. So the real issue for me begins to impact down onto the small to mid-size business. And the challenge in that is, of course, we're all now interrelated in terms of the way that we go about conducting our business today. Large organizations are dependent very often on smaller organizations and vice versa. So we have to look at it across the entirety of what does, you know, legislation and regulation do, not just from the burden, if you like, that it creates from a compliance standpoint, but also on some of the implications of the way in which we go about doing our day-to-day business.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about critical infrastructure. The security of that infrastructure is under the spotlight. So will we see an increase in legislation intended to protect national infrastructure? And is that the strongest tool? Or are there better, perhaps more efficient remedies that we can deploy?
I think critical national infrastructure is an area that we're all concerned about.
Mm.
It tends to give rise to some fairly emotional reactions, I think, from people when we actually think about some of the implications of it not being available. Because for a lot of us, of course, we take it for granted. You know, we flick a light switch, we assume that the light will come on. Well, that's electricity. That's part of the critical national infrastructure. We go along to our bank, we want to take money out of an ATM, and we assume it's going to be working. We're using our mobile phones to pay for things. We assume that the infrastructure for there is going to be working. So we make a number of assumptions. And I think that that in itself gives rise to one of the very big challenges around availability of national infrastructure. And so are we going to legislate around it? Are we going to see more legislation around it? Well, you highlighted one of the challenges around legislation right at the beginning. And that is that legislation is always going to be behind.
Mm.
That is just the way that it is. Trying to produce, you know, regulation or legislation that is forward-looking, I think for lawmakers is well nigh impossible. And so I think what we do need to see in this particular area is two things. First, I think very much more interaction and collaboration between government and private sector in terms of what does regulation or legislation need to look like. We've started to see some quite strong pushback from big tech, for instance, around some of the regulations that are being talked about, certainly when it comes to things like privacy, for instance. Mm. So I think there's a need for us to collaborate and work together better in that particular space. And then I think we need to also understand what it is that the regulation or the legislation is trying to do. And again, that may sound strange to some people, but if I look at GDPR, for instance. Now, GDPR is all about privacy. It's about protecting personally identifiable information. The original premise around that was that an individual within the EU has a right to own his or her data.
Mm-hmm.
And that anybody who is using that data therefore has a right to protect it. So it was about the right of the individual, actually, fundamentally, GDPR. One of the byproducts of it having come out is that everybody is now talking about privacy and about how we protect information.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't necessarily the starting point. And so I think it's important for us to really look at and examine, you know, the whole tail associated with legislation. And that is the real challenge, I think, for regulators and legislators. And that's why I think for a very long time, we haven't seen them showing too much enthusiasm to regulate in this particular space. You know, one of the very common pushbacks here in the United States from Congress in particular was that there was a reluctance for them to put anything on the statute books because as soon as they did, it would be out of date.
Mm-hmm.
And once it's on the statute books, it's incredibly difficult to change or remove.
Right.
And so better to stand back, watch, wait. And so this is a particularly challenging area. When it comes to critical national infrastructure, however, we do have to see, I think, steps being taken to ensure that it is protected. Is legislation the right way to do that? I don't know. I probably wouldn't go quite that far myself. I think that it is better to have fairly strong guidelines. I would like to see much more collaboration. The counter to that, of course, is, you know, it isn't going to work. The only thing that people respond to is firm legislation. And so therefore, that's what we need to have in that space. I certainly don't have the answer to it. I think we're going to see a continued debate around it. I think it is a huge area of concern, one that we need to address. My own view is that we're not going to come up with the right answer.
Hmm. You mentioned collaboration, so let's talk about that. Legislation is obviously focused on the needs and culture of local, regional, or national entities. But cybercrime ignores national boundaries and thus necessitates a level of international collaboration that I think is unprecedented. So how can governments shift their focus to cross-border collaboration when we don't really have much of a roadmap to refer to?
We don't. And I would also add to that that individual governments probably also don't have very much incentive to operate outside of their own national jurisdiction. I put that question to a member of parliament just a few weeks ago, and his response to me was that his role, as he saw it, was to really ensure that the national boundaries were being protected and to focus on that first. And there was so much that needed to be done within the national boundary that that had to be the priority. And anything that they were then able to do internationally was just a benefit and a byproduct, potentially, of the work that they'd done within the national boundary. So is there a particularly strong motivation for us to collaborate collectively across borders? I would probably say not at the moment. We see some of this challenge with law enforcement, trying to track down cyber criminals. There are certain parts of the world where cyber criminals know they have safe haven. There is a degree of collaboration across Interpol with and Europol, of course, with that sharing of information. And we've got better in that particular area. But I think that's where it necessarily starts. I think the other thing that we will see is, and I'm going to go back again to the GDPR, we will see some key pieces of legislation coming out of either individual countries or regions, such as the European Union, where other countries then say, hang on a minute, if we have to comply with this within a trading bloc, then we probably need to have our own version of it and let's adopt the highest bar possible for that, because then that opens up a number of different markets. And so I think that, again, that was what I would describe as being a byproduct of the way in which GDPR was being implemented. It wasn't necessarily one of the founding principles of it. And I think that's more likely to be the way that we're going to see things developing.
Mm-hmm. Steve, should corporate enterprises rely on legislation as the best way to ensure cyber resilience? I'm curious if you'll talk about the tension between companies trying to successfully execute their business plans and rely on legislation to assist them. Do you think that enterprises and governments can partner more successfully in this way? And do you see any creative partnerships bringing productive energy to these challenges?
I think it's always a challenge when you look at legislation or regulation. You know, let's look at the financial services industry around the world. Every country has its own monetary authority. It's called a number of different things, but it is the regulator, effectively. And we see different regulators adopting different stances for the way in which they work with those financial services organizations in their jurisdiction. Some of them have a much more collaborative and open approach, an advisory approach that they've adopted because they want to encourage companies to talk to them about the challenges that they've got. Others take a very much more prescriptive, almost traffic cop type approach to it, where they see their role as being to suddenly swoop in and catch people out. And I don't know that there is a right or wrong answer to that. I do think, however, that if we're going to be successful in this particular space, we need to be encouraging very much more collaboration, whether that be with the regulator, whether it be with legislative bodies, whether it be with organizations in different sectors. There is a need, I think, for an organization to really know your legislation. You have to understand some of the implications of legislation if you're going to do business across national borders. And if you're a large organization, of course, you'll be in the lucky position perhaps of having, a number of people who can help you out with that. If you're a small to mid-sized organization, perhaps not so much. And so that, I think, is where some of the attention needs to be focused. And government can do quite a lot to make life easier for those sorts of businesses by making it more obvious to them what legislation does apply, how they can go about complying with it, providing some advice and some tips. And we've seen certain governments do that. In the UK, we've got things like the Cyber Essentials. UK government's quite keen to encourage organisations to really understand how they can be much safer in cyber. That doesn't go so far as to how you might be able to then operate across multiple borders, but there are other organisations within UK government that you can approach that will help you out with that, and indeed with market entry and so on. So I think those sorts of things are going to become increasingly more important as we go forward. But again, the key to it for me is about transparency and collaboration and sharing information.
Mm-hmm. Legislation by its nature is government and regulator driven, resulting in a move towards national regulation at a time when cross-border collaboration, as you say, is desperately needed. Organizations and governments will struggle to keep abreast of rapid developments in cyberspace, which also impact business models many have taken for granted. This will be of particular challenge to cloud implementations, where a full picture of the location of cloud data has been an oversight. When you come back next time, Steve, let's talk about the third area that you've identified as a top threat in 2019. I want to discuss the challenge of data integrity in smart devices. Until we return, for valuable resources, more important and timely conversations, and tools that will help you safeguard your data privacy, visit securityforum.org. And listeners, we want to hear from you. If there's a guest you'd like us to bring into the studio, a topic you'd like to hear covered, get in touch with us. You can tweet us at Security Forum or send a message through our website. Thanks for listening, and we'll be back soon.